So today we are going to be talking about pesticide emergencies. And if when I say pesticide emergencies, you feel like this goat on the screen, that's okay. Sometimes I feel that way too. But we hope that by the end of the presentation, you will not have as crazy of eyes or feel as stressed out as this goat looks. Our goal today is to cover these topics. So, you know, the responsibility of an employer and what they should be providing to their employees to prevent, you know, pesticide emergencies, as well as what sort of resources they should be providing during a pesticide emergency. Lisa's going to go more into more detail about those things, but we're also going to talk about spill prevention and then proper spill cleanup procedures. What type of first aid you should be providing to people during a pesticide medical emergency. So when someone has had pesticides either ingested or spilled onto their bodies. And also we're going to talk about who you should be contacting during a pesticide emergency. So with that, I'm going to send it on to Lisa. She's going to get started.
Good afternoon, everybody. So we're going to talk about just some of the basics for preventing pesticide emergencies. And employers are responsible for ensuring that all pesticide handlers receive training on spill response and first aid. So workers who work with or around pesticides are required to get annual safety training on pesticide safety. And for our field workers and our handlers, that includes first aid, but our pesticide handlers get first aid, but they also get spill response training. So this is training that's in accordance with California Code of Regulation. It's section 6724, and it requires employers have to provide this training. So that's a key step in preventing pesticide emergencies, is letting everybody know the proper safety procedures and prevention tactics. Oh, I forgot I wasn't in charge of the mouse. So as part of this training and as a continual retraining opportunity, I hope that you guys are all familiar with these. These are the Pesticide Safety Information Series leaflets. There's a series for an A series for ag, people who work in ag production, and an equivalent N series for those who work in non-ag. So whether you work in ag production or you work in landscape maintenance, there's a PSIS for you. And in fact, they're available in English, Spanish, Punjabi, and Hmong. And so these form part, they're an important part of your annual pesticide safety training. So this particular one, it's A2 or N2, talks about storing, moving, and disposing of pesticides, okay? And so on there's a page in here. I forget which page it is, like page 3 or 4, that's specifically talks about spill response. So this covers a lot of the handling tasks that your pesticide handlers will have to complete. And so they can be used as part of the annual training, but they can also be displayed at the work site. And displayed means that workers have access to them without having to ask permission. So they might be on a bulletin board and they may have to take them off the bulletin board to see all the information, but they never need to ask permission to access the office or whatever location the bulletin board is. So they have access to these pesticide safety information series anytime they're at work. Okay, next slide. And so this is another PSIS that is going to be integral to your training or as left and display as a reminder to our employees. So it's the A4 or the N4, and it talks all about first aid and emergency decontamination. Next slide. So another really key element in preventing pesticide emergencies is something that you have to do because Cal OSHA mandates it, okay? So it's called the Injury and Illness Prevention Program, the IIPP. Those of you who are safety supervisors or have some safety responsibilities at your jobs, you know what this is, right? So Cal OSHA requires all employers in California to have an IIPP. And it basically documents like potential hazards at the workplace and all of the procedures that must be followed to prevent and respond to and correct any safety issues at the workplace. So we have colleagues at the Western Center for Agricultural Health and Safety, and we'll put the link up in the chat in just a minute, and they give trainings on IIPP. And in fact, this visual that you see is a guide that they use, and it helps you. It essentially is a training tool, but it serves as your template for an IIPP as well. And so the thing is, your pesticide safety procedures are primarily mandated by the Department of Pesticide Regulation or your Ag Commissioner, who work with the Department of Pesticide Regulation. But your regular safety procedures need to be identified and documented in your IIPP. So this IIPP is a comprehensive safety program. So it's got pesticide stuff in there. It's got slip, trip, and fall stuff. If you use ladders at work, that's all incorporated. Okay, but pesticides form a part of it. So for example, when you're identifying job hazards, you conduct a chemical inventory, and pesticides are included in your chemical inventory, okay? You must also document annual pesticide safety training in your training section. So anything that you're doing for safety with pesticides has to be incorporated into your IIPP.
Lisa, before you move on, we have a question in Q&A.
Okay. Can you tell me what it is? I don't have it open.
Michelle is asking, does fumigation practices require A series or N series?
That's a great question. It depends on what kind of fumigation that you're doing. So if you're doing soil fumigation as a pre-plant treatment before you go in and plant like strawberries or almonds or what have you, if you're eventually going to plant an agricultural commodity there, then it's an A series. So it's for ag. But if you're doing fumigation like structures or grain bins or something like that, that is not essential to agricultural production, then that would be the N series. Are there any more questions?
Not at the moment.
Okay, thank you. All right, next slide. So again, as part of prevention of pesticide emergencies, handlers and field workers must be trained annually, and they also must be told where this really good safety information and the PSISs are so they can remind themselves. And honestly, like if you're finding that you're noticing that your employees are not following safety procedures, retraining is an option, and it is, in fact, is something that you should be doing. And so we need to train our workers how to follow the label, because that's going to help them with proper storage, transport, and disposal. And they're going to know what is the appropriate PPE or personal protective equipment for the task that they're doing. Okay, next. So just a reminder that there is a hierarchy of controls. So at the top, you have the wider part of the triangle. That means that procedure or that approach to safety is more protective than what's at the bottom, okay? So I'll go through these just a very quick example as they relate to your work with pesticides. So you could eliminate a hazard, and that's the absolute safest thing to do. Don't use a pesticide, right? But that's not always the answer. You may not be able to get around not using a pesticide. So you can go to the next level, which is less protective, but still a good approach. So substitution, you could use a pesticide that's, for example, less toxic. And again, you can use multiple ones of these on this list, okay? So maybe you decide to use that or you don't. An engineering control is something like a closed mixing system for pesticides, or it's making an application in an enclosed cap. That's like mechanical things that separate the person from the hazard. We have administrative controls, which are always going to be part of any safety program. And those are things like our annual pesticide safety training. Those are things like field posting signs. So anything that's really administrative, notifying people, training people, informing people. And then the last line of defense is personal protective equipment, which obviously we're going to wear whenever we are handling pesticides, but the PPE is the last line of defense. It's crucial to safety, but it is truly the last line of defense. We need to address the hazard at all of these other levels first, because they're just more protective. So PPE is very protective, but it's less protective than, say, not using the pesticide itself. So just think about it like that. PPE is not the only thing that you can do to keep yourself safe from pesticides. So I want to just entreat you to wear your PPE, right? So you can go ahead and, the two arrows are great. So this is why you should wear PPE. First of all, this guy is making a pesticide application, right? This person, and he's wearing long pants, socks, closed-toed shoes. He's wearing long sleeves, but they're rolled up, so it doesn't even count. And furthermore, he's not wearing protective eyewear, and he's not wearing chemical-resistant gloves. And we know that our employees who handle pesticides must wear that as a minimum, right? Because we're in California. So we looked at a 10 years worth of data from the Pesticide Illness Surveillance Program, or the PISP database, not PIST, I'm just fine, it's PISP. And so that those data showed that over a 10-year period, they looked at occupational handler illnesses, and 55% of the reported illnesses by occupational handlers involved eye injury, either alone or with some other injury, right? So 55% of the time that somebody reported an illness, it was to their eyes. You have two eyeballs, we need to protect them, right? 28% of the time, those handler illnesses involve skin injury, either alone or in combination. But look at this bottom number. This is the most important thing that I want you to take away from today. From just this slide, not just today. So a third of all handler pesticide illnesses were due to failure to wear PPE. So basically, wearing the appropriate PPE for that handling task, we could have reduced the number of handler injuries by one third. So that's what I'll leave you with my PPE statements.
So I'm gonna have you all answer this poll. So I'll read it out loud. And then if you can't see it or respond to it, feel free to put it in the chat. But what are the three C's of spill cleanup procedure? Are they control, contain, clean? Are they cry, curse, clean? It's a valuable option. is it collect, clean, continue? Okay, so yes. Okay, so all of you who answered the poll, answered it correctly. So the three C's of pesticide spill cleanup are control, contain, clean. I think the cry, curse, and clean, that could be maybe an internal response, but it's not the response we were going for today. So, but when you have a pesticide spill, you want to be thinking about how to clean it up, right? And so usually in an emergency, you're not always thinking clearly. So as long as you can remember the three C's, these control, contain, clean, you'll be doing okay. Something I want to mention though, before you even begin to try and control a pesticide spill, it's important to remember to be wearing the appropriate PPE, because cleaning or trying to clean up a pesticide spill is considered a handling activity, and therefore you need to be wearing the appropriate PPE for that activity. So we'll go into that a little later, but I just wanted to reiterate, PPE is so important, like Lisa was stating earlier. We can't mention it enough. We can't encourage you to use it enough. It is required by law. And so I'll leave it at that. Okay, so the first C, control. What does control mean? So basically you just wanna stop the spill from continuing, right? So that means like you would shut off, if it's a machine, you'd shut off the mixing or the application equipment if it's leaking, or like in this picture, for example, the container is spilled over, you would just pick it up and maybe cap it if you can find the cap to stop the spill from getting any worse. If it's like a broken container or it's leaking, put it inside of another container so that's not just spilling out all over the ground, all over the place. So you wanna make sure that it's controlled, because if you're trying to clean it up or contain it and it's still leaking out everywhere, it's kind of like, I don't know, chasing cats or trying to herd cats around, you know, it's just not gonna be successful. So the first thing you wanna do is stop that spill from getting any worse or from happening, or from getting any worse, excuse me. So the second C, after you've put the container upright or you've turned off all the equipment or you've put it in a different container to catch the spill, now you're going to try and contain the spill. And so this is when you want to stop the spill from spreading. So like in this picture here, you see the liquid. So you would surround it with like these little, I think they're called snakes. So typically they're filled with like straw. I've only seen them filled with straw, but maybe like sawdust or anything that's going to be absorbent. You want to circle the spill with that. So that could either be those, you could have, you got these little pads to absorb it. You could also make like a little ditch around the spill or a mound of dirt to stop it from spreading farther, sort of like a little reservoir. And then you also want to make sure that you're not having other people come in the area, right? You want to keep people away because these are pesticides, they're hazardous materials, and there's probably not enough PPE to go around for the whole, all of the public that might be interested in rubbernecking, I think, as they say, to see what happened. And actually, I was looking at this presentation last night, and I noticed this picture is a little misleading because if you'll see here, what do you see that is possibly not correct in this photo? You can put it in the chat. So they're containing the spill in this photo, but did they follow the first C of control? What do you think? It looks like no, because I still see pesticide leaking out of this container. So really, this should be the container is maybe propped upright or they put a lid on it to stop that spill from leaking any further. Anyway, so then the third C is the clean. So you've stopped the spill from getting worse. You've contained it into a manageable area. Now you're ready to be, to be cleaning it up. So you want to be using materials from your spill kit, and we'll get to that in the next slide. But you want to be absorbing the material. You don't necessarily want to use water and spraying it and trying to dilute it. In this situation, dilution is not the solution. You want to be absorbing that pesticide and containing it. So you'll soak it up with sponges or sawdust or cat litter, anything that's absorbent. And then you're going to be putting it into, you know, a container or heavy bags to then dispose of as hazardous waste because they're saturated with that pesticide and they won't be able to go to a normal landfill. You'll have to dispose of them at a hazardous waste site. So typically your county ag commissioner would know a good spot for that. Or, you know, if you have old pesticides that you have disposed of before, that's probably the same place you disposed of those. You could probably dispose of your pesticide spill materials there as well. And so something to keep in mind is if you have this, if the spill occurred on soil, you have to shovel out at least the top 2 to 3 inches. So that's probably about that much soil. And that's just because the pesticide is going to have leaked down into that soil and contaminated that soil. And so you don't want to leave anything left. So you're going to take all that, you're going to put all that soil into the bag or into the container that you're using as sort of your like trash bag for these pesticides, right? And so once you've cleaned it up, you've absorbed all that pesticide or you've scooped out all the soil, you want to make sure that you label your trash container. I'm going to call it a trash container. So that's either a plastic bin or a heavy duty bag. You want to label it with the name of the pesticide and the signal word. And that's just because you label all your pesticide containers. Why would you not do the same? Even though it's not usable pesticide, it still is that hazardous material and you still need to be aware of what you're using. So, you know, label that, trash and then dispose of it properly so you can talk to your county ag commissioner and they can help you find a place to do that. And the faster that you can clean up or contain a spill and dispose of that pesticide, the less chance that it's going to cause harm either to the environment or to other people. So speed is of the essence, but you also want to make sure that you're doing it correctly and you're doing it well because you don't want to have random pesticides lying around and just hanging out. Okay, so we're going to move on. We're going to talk about spill kits. So I just told you, you know, you need to clean up your pesticide spills, but how do you do that, right? So can we launch the poll for the spill kits, please? Okay, so we have a poll on the screen and it's asking, what are some components that must be included in a spill kit? So you can choose all that apply. So we have PPE, absorbent material, snacks, and numbers for emergency assistance. So what of those four components do you think should be included in a spill kit? You all are very quick to respond. I appreciate it. Okay, wow. So we got everybody responding. Okay, I feel like you have seen this presentation before because you all answered correctly. So what should be in a spill kit among many other things? I'll actually go to the next slide. Our PPE, excuse me, that poll is wily. Okay, our PPE, absorbent material, and phone number, emergency phone number. So, but that's not the only thing. You also want to have this list that you see on the screen here. So your spill kit's going to be a pretty hefty, it's going to have a lot of stuff in it, but that's to your benefit. You don't want to have snacks in there. No one said snacks, but, you know, I think we all know that when dealing with pesticides, we don't really want to mix food or personal items with pesticide related items, right? So you want to keep, it's just business with your spill kit. Okay. So that's going to include phone numbers for emergencies. So that could be medical numbers. So the name or the number of your doctor, a medical doctor, which we will also talk about in a little bit. Maybe in the number of the California Office of Emergency Services, maybe Highway Patrol, depends if you're traveling with pesticides and they spill on the highway. You also want to make sure you have the appropriate PPE for the pesticide you're using. So if you you want to have the most protective PPE for the pesticides you're using. So whichever pesticide requires the most PPE, that is the PPE that you should have in your spill kit, okay? And then you also want to have things like containment tubes or pads, which would just go around the spill to contain it, absorbent materials, stuff to sweep up dry spills, so like granules or dusts. You don't have to necessarily get those wet, you can just sweep them up. Also a shovel, broom, dustpan for the sweeping, possibly heavy duty detergent, a fire extinguisher, and then other spill cleanup items that might be on the label or something that you find necessary. So I actually want to ask you all right now to post in the chat if there's anything in your spill kit at your place of employment. I said that weird, but if what is in your spill kit that maybe you don't see on the screen here? So post it in the chat, something in your spill kit that you don't see on the screen. And I will wait for some responses. Let's see what we have. Okay, so Andrea said a broom. Yeah, so a broom is really important for sweeping up dried pesticide materials. That is true. So anyone else have anything in their spill kits that we haven't mentioned on the screen? Just wait for some responses. Also, when you, a warning sign. Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah, a warning sign. Is that for warning the public that there was a pesticide spill, or is that, could you clarify the person who posted that? I can't read the, can't read who posted it. So while we're waiting for that response, also, yes, to exclude, okay, so the warning sign is for excluding any members of the public. Yeah, so that's a good idea, right? You wanna protect the public, you wanna protect your employees, but you're also trying to protect the public. That's really good. So you should be keeping these spill kits anywhere that you are handling pesticides. So typically that's, you know, a pesticide storage facility. If you're transporting pesticides, it should be in the vehicle that's transporting pesticides. should also be in the mixing and loading site. So really, if you have pesticides or you're handling pesticides, you should have a spill kit right there ready to go in case anything happens. And I also see Aaron posted, they have reflective cones to quarantine the area. Yeah, that's good. Directions to the nearest phone. Awesome. Yeah, these are all good options. So you should have a bunch of stuff in your spill kit and it should be easily accessible no matter where you are. Maria, do we have a question in the Q&A?
Yes, I was just going to alert you to
that. Can you read it to me? I can't open it right now.
Yeah, I can read it to you. It says, are fire extinguishers required? Is it best practice? We have FE in our fire extinguishers in our trucks, but not dedicated for spill emergencies.
Lisa, do you want to answer that question? I'm not sure I could respond correctly.
Yeah, I think all of this is, as far as the California Code of Regulations and the Department of Pesticide Regulation, you know, they say you have to have a spill kit, but there's not a very specific list of things to put in. So we really rely on best practices. So if it's not appropriate for you to have a fire extinguisher in your spill kit because you've got them in more accessible places, then that's completely fine. Again, you know, I just want to bring it back to the IIPP that should be documented there. And it should be in any kind of training, either on fire extinguisher or on extinguishing pesticide fires. People should just know where they are. So it's not enough to have, you know, spill kit and all these wonderful things. You have to also inform people what's in the spill kit and where the things are, including the fire extinguisher if they're not in the spill kit.
Thanks, Lisa. Okay, so we're gonna move on. So I want you all to post in the chat, what do you think about this picture? Do you think how this guy is handling the spill is good or bad? I'll wait for some responses in the chat. I'll give you a second to think about it. Okay, so I see bad. I see bad, no PPE. That is correct. It's always bad when there's no PPE. Okay, so it looks like the general consensus is that this is not a good way to handle a spill. So yeah, I'm seeing things like needs gloves, it's not contained, the spill isn't contained, the container's not upright, more bad. Okay, yes. So, okay, we're all in agreement, not a great example. So yeah, exactly. So first of all, this person didn't contain the spill. C number one contained. So he should have propped this container up, upright and put the lid on it. Actually, excuse me, I'm going to backtrack. Before he did anything, he should have put on the appropriate PPE. So let's just assume this is a category three, or it's a pesticide. The label says minimum PPE, right? So in California, he should be wearing a long sleeve shirt. He's got his long pants on. He's got his closed toed shoes and socks, but he should also be wearing gloves and eye protection. So that should have been a first step. He should have gotten it from a spill kit, taken out the correct PPE. Then he should have contained, put the container upright. Then he should have surrounded the spill with some sort of absorbent material to stop it from going further. And then he should have started in on what he's now doing as the first step, which should actually have been more like the fourth step of absorbing it and trying to clean it up. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to move on. So I just talked about pesticide spills without really the human component, I guess you could say. So a pesticide spill is an emergency, right? It becomes an even bigger emergency when it involves a person getting pesticide spilled on them. So not only is it stressful because you just spilled pesticides and it's contaminating the environment, but then it becomes stressful because it becomes a medical emergency and someone has been exposed to pesticides. So we're going to talk a little bit about how you would prevent that. And Lisa discussed this a little bit as well in the beginning. How do you prevent an emergency, a pesticide emergency, from becoming possibly a pesticide medical emergency, if that makes any sense. So here you'll see we have Miguel and there's arrows pointing to different parts of his body. So there's four different ways pesticides can enter our bodies. It's through our eyes, our nose, our mouth, and our skin. So most commonly though, pesticides enter our bodies through our skin. And that's just because, you know, our eyes, we have two eyes. They're pretty small in comparison to the rest of our body. Same with our nose and our mouth, but our skin covers our entire body from head to toe. So it just makes more sense that it would be easier for our skin to get exposed to pesticides. So how do we protect ourselves in the case of a pesticide spill or an accident of some kind? How do we protect ourselves from a pesticide exposure or having a pesticide medical emergency? Well, as Lisa was mentioning earlier, PPE. We can't stress this enough. PPE, even though it's supposed to, it's the last line of defense in that hierarchy of controls, it's still a very, very important aspect to any handling activity, and it is required by law to be wearing the appropriate PPE. So we're gonna launch number poll, the PPE poll regarding minimum PPE in California. So in California, most pesticide handlers have to wear a minimum of what PPE? And you can choose all that apply. So we have waterproof gloves, chemical resistant gloves, respirator, long pants, long sleeve shirt, closed-toed shoes, socks, protective eyewear, chemical resistant boots. So of those options, what is the minimum PPE that you must wear when handling pesticides in California? Yes. So I just lost my train of thought. Okay, here you'll see Miguel is wearing the federal minimum regulation PPE requirements. So federally, you're required to wear, that means in every state in the nation, at least you have to be wearing long sleeve shirt, long pants, closed toed shoes, socks. That's great, but in California, and we'll referring back to that slide Lisa showed us about how about 50% of handler injuries were to the eye, and there was like, I think 30%, 23% with the skin or with hands. So in California, we have more restrictive PPE, so we have to also wear protective eyewear, chemical resistant gloves, and sometimes coveralls, but minimum PPE in California, long sleeve shirt, long pants, closed toed shoes and socks, as well as protective eyewear. So this could be these types of glasses. They could also be goggles or a face shield, chemical resistant gloves. And if you're using a pesticide that has the signal word danger or warning, you also have to be wearing coveralls in California. So actually I'm gonna stop sharing the poll. And so to prevent a pesticide spill or a pesticide emergency from becoming a medical emergency, PPE is going to protect you. I'm not saying it's perfect, but it is going to do a lot of good. If a pesticide spills on you, but you're wearing gloves, that might just be the thing that changes your day from like, oh crap, we got pesticides on the ground, versus, oh crap, we have to take Jim to the hospital because he just got a pesticide spilled all over his skin and he's having a pesticide poisoning incident. So I'm going to stop talking. I'm going to let Lisa go on to the next slide, which is first aid. So
thanks for that lead in. So, if at some point in time you do have this, oh crap, Jim got hurt moment, and you find yourself in need to provide first aid for people, first aid is a lot of things. It's great, but it is not a substitute for medical care. It is the care that we give to someone while we're either waiting for the ambulance or while we're getting ready to take them to a medical facility, okay? So it's always a good idea to take somebody in to have a medical professional look at them after you've administered them first aid because of a pesticide exposure. Because, you know, we're talking about, we're talking about more like acute or short-term incidents at the moment. But sometimes those those effects are delayed like 24 to 48 hours before they really set in. And so if you haven't seen a medical professional, or you haven't sent somebody to see a medical professional, and then they go home for the weekend, and then, you know, their symptoms really set in, they could be in a lot of, that could become a really bad situation for them. So in the case of an emergency, it's, if you're not the supervisor, you need to notify the supervisor immediately. But also, you know, before you start administering first aid, you need to make sure that you are protecting yourself. It's bad enough that Jim needs your help, but you don't need to also get help because you're helping Jim. So just keep that in mind. It's not a substitute for medical care, and you're not putting on this invisibility cloak that protects you from pesticides when you're helping another person. You need to, you know, it's just like in the air, in the airplane, right? You know, you have to put on your face mask first. Before you help somebody else. Okay, let's go to the poll. So true or false, you can find first aid information in the precautionary statements section of the label. Just as a note, some other sections of the label, you know, there's precautionary statements, there's directions for use, there's storage and disposal. Those are some different sections of the label. So do you think precautionary statements is the right one? And so the answer, most of you responded true, and that is correct. That is the section in which you will find first aid statements. And I'm going to show you an example of a label. So here, I don't know if you can see it very well, but look, there's a precautionary statements, and it's not just first aid. So first aid is right here. It's smashed in there. I mean, technically it is part of the section of the label that's called precautionary statements. And this tells you how to protect the pesticide handler, bystanders, and the environment from the ill effects of this pesticide. So first aid is obviously first on that list, but precautionary statements also have, the personal protective equipment statements on there. And they also have things like toxic to aquatic invertebrates and things like that. So precautions on how to use this pesticide safely and appropriately. Okay, so I'm gonna take you through each of those four routes of exposure and give you basic first aid overview. So remember how we talked about the Pesticide Safety Information Series earlier in the presentation, and I think it was the A4 that gives first aid. Okay, first aid is for pesticide exposure is pretty general, but you will also find it on the label. So what you need to know, what you need to do before you're either handling a pesticide or training somebody to handle that pesticide, is review that pesticide label, the first aid statements, just to make sure the standard approach is correct. Because there's some pesticides that are extremely corrosive. And so maybe their first aid might be just a little bit different. So skin is mostly always the same, okay? You need to immediately remove the affected clothing. So if you've got a spill on your PPE or your long sleeve shirt or what have you, you need to remove that clothing from your body and immediately rinse the pesticide off, and then eventually wash with soap and water. So this is gonna happen for you could rinse for like 15 to 20 minutes, okay? And remember how I said like the most, common route of exposure is skin. So this happens pretty frequently, or I'm not gonna say it happens pretty frequently, but it is more one of the more common ways that in which people get exposed to pesticides. So what do you think? If this guy's taken off this shirt because it got pesticides on it, and then he washes himself up, and then what does he do with this shirt that he's taken off his body? Tell me in the chat, what do you think he's supposed to be doing with the shirt? I mean, basically my question is, can he ever wear that shirt again? Yes or no? Can he ever return to wearing that shirt? I'm just gonna go with what Cindy said. She said, bag it and toss it, and that is correct. If you've got a significant amount of pesticides on your clothing, you need to take it off, wash your skin, put on a different shirt, bag that shirt, and then it's gone. If you have a soaked through shirt or pants or socks or whatever, you're never going to get them completely clean of pesticides. You're never washing all of the pesticides out of them. So don't wear your favorite clothes to work. That is just a word to the wise. Okay, so we'll go to the next slide. So eyes are really sensitive, okay? And so this is really important. And most labels will give you the same instructions for dealing with eyes, but there's also some tips that you need to know. So basically you're gonna flush your eyes with clean, like moderate temperature water for 15 to 20 minutes. So in this picture, you see somebody wearing, somebody using a hose, because that's the best available potable water, you know, best available water to them. If you have an eye wash fountain where you like push it on it with your feet and then the water comes out like that, the thing is, you're supposed to hold your eyes open. And I've done this. I've used an eye wash station and not in an emergency. I was just testing it out. And it's not easy. As soon as you start spraying water on your eyes want to close because they're like, oh my God, because nobody wants water sprayed in their eyes. So that is a tough thing. If you are holding open your eyes, but you've got gloves on, you have to take those gloves off first. So that's just a word to the wise. So your eyes have to remain open. But if you only have one eye or the other that's been impacted by pesticides, that eye needs to go towards the ground, and then you eye wash it like this, either, you know, just like an eye wash bottle or with a hose or whatever materials you have available to you. So it's really important if you have pesticide in this eye that you don't wash it down into the other eye, okay? So best case scenario, you have an eye wash station and you can remove your gloves and then you hold open your eyes and you press down on the pedal with your foot, okay? So how about, let's go to the next slide. So when you have pesticide exposure, like through ingestion, this is where you really need to know what the label and the SDS tell you what to do, okay? Because basically you need to get medical attention like ASAP. I'm gonna say for most times you're administering first aid, you really should be seeking medical attention, but this one, acts swiftly if somebody ingests pesticide, because depending on the pesticide, it could be a really bad situation for them. So you basically just need to get them to a doctor and only follow specific instructions about that pesticide. You don't want to give them milk or give them water or activated charcoal if your label or a medical professional does not expressly tell you that. It is extremely important. So tell me, why would you not just make somebody vomit if they've ingested pesticides? Tell me in the chat why the answer isn't to make them vomit, provoke vomiting. Yeah, so Luis is saying if it's very corrosive, it can cause more harm leaving your body than it is just staying there and being absorbed in some way, okay? So you never want to provoke vomiting for somebody unless you've got very specific instructions. Either the label says it, or you're talking to a medical professional and they know exactly what pesticide you're applying because they've got the EPA registration number, and then they tell you, okay? So I can't stress that enough. It's not a one size fits all approach for ingestion. And then for respiratory exposure, this is another one where it's really important to get this person a medical attention, like speed is essential. But also this is another one where your instinct may be to like run into a greenhouse where you've seen somebody passed out and you suppose that they've been exposed to pesticides. They've inhaled too many pesticides. Don't just like don't superwoman it, okay? Don't just like rip open the door and run in there and save this person, because you need to save yourself first. Just remember, respiratory hazards, you can't always detect them until it's too late. So please protect yourself. And then you need to move the victim to fresh air, loosen their clothing. And if you're trained in CPR and you also have a barrier on hand, then you can give mouth to mouth resuscitation if they are not breathing. So I'm highly trained in first aid. So yeah, you need to be trained in first aid. This is part of our annual training. This is documented in the IIPP. And as you can probably tell, first aid for pesticide exposures is not what they're going to teach you in an American Red Cross first aid course. That is very solid information for dealing with injuries of all types, but responding to pesticide emergencies is a little bit more specific. Okay, I think I need to stop talking.
Okay, thanks, Lisa. Yeah, I'll try and speed it up too. It looks like we have a question in the Q&A.
It was a comment or an observation about getting it in the lungs. So it was,
Okay, thanks, Maria.
If for the person that offered the observation and Q&A, if you have any specific questions that we didn't address, please let us know. I'm thinking it's an observation, but I might be wrong.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so Lisa just went over the first aid, and you should all feel like that person in that last meme or whatever, feeling prepared for a pesticide emergency. But that's not the only thing. So if you're administering first aid, that's really step one in a series of things that you should be doing during a pesticide emergency. So yeah, so first off, yeah, okay, so you're administering first aid, clearly Jim's in trouble. You gotta get going, right? So while you're administering first aid, you should also be, whether it's you, actually probably shouldn't be you if you're administering first aid, you should have another employee be getting information from the label or the safety data sheet from the pesticide that Jim was exposed to or whoever was exposed to. You should also be contacting either a poison control center or the medical facility that you will be going to taking, I'm just gonna keep using Jim as an example, contacting them, letting them know you're coming, providing them with specific information that I'm gonna ask in just a minute. So first aid is the first step in a series of events that should be happening. And so really the next step is to be finding out what pesticide you were using and certain information that you can then give to your medical providers, because it's gonna make everyone's life easier and it's gonna be a lot more efficient use of your time during the emergency. And again, prevention is always better than providing treatment. So always remember to wear the appropriate PPE and these types of things, these pesticide emergencies could be avoided. So we're gonna quickly launch poll number 5, pesticide information. Okay, so this poll is asking, so you're administering first aid, and then you're calling the medical facility or you're calling poison control being like, hey, Jim's not doing too well. They're going to be asking you questions, or they should be asking you questions. If they're not, you need to be prepared with what to tell them so that you can help Jim get through this pesticide emergency and have a good weekend, you know? So what in the poll question is asking, what information should you give to the medical provider about the pesticide? So you can choose all that apply. So we have product name, EPA registration number, active ingredients, medical information from the product labeling, the circumstances of application, and the circumstances of exposure. So what do you think you should be giving to the medical provider regarding the pesticide? What information from this list should you be giving them? Yeah, so most of you chose every single response, and that is correct. You want to be giving these people as much information as you can, right? If you can give them all of these things, perfect. The more the merrier. Like, they need to know exactly what they're getting into, because that's going to help them decide how to better treat Jim and what sort of treatment he needs. If you don't have this, all of this information, the most important thing that you can give them is the EPA registration number of the pesticide that Jim was exposed to. So this is typically the number that's on the front of the label. And I believe, Lisa, correct me if I'm wrong, it'll say, it'll have the letters EPA, and then it'll have a bunch of numbers after it, right? So that's, and it's typically a, right above another number that's going to have some other letters like CA or TX or something like that, but you don't want that one. You want to see the one that says EPA, then a bunch of numbers. So if you can't give them the product name, thank you, Lisa, or the active ingredient, give them the EPA registration number, because that's a very, very unique identifier to that pesticide. And so that's going to provide them all the information that they'll need to know to help Jim out. So keep that in mind, you know, give them as much as you can. Active ingredient is another important one, but you know, in emergencies, we're not always thinking clearly, or maybe we can't find all the information in time. So your eyes should be going right for that EPA registration number, which should be on the front of the label, I think typically near the bottom. But anyways, okay. Also, something else to keep in mind is you don't ever want to bring the actual container, the pesticide container with you. I mean, it's great because you're like, okay, well, it says here that it has this active ingredient, this percentage, but think about what you're doing. You're bringing a pesticide container that's considered a hazardous material into a hospital. That's not helping the situation. So, you know, maybe take a picture of it, or if you have the label that's not on the container, bring that with you, or the safety data sheet, but you really shouldn't be bringing the container with you. Also, if, yes. Okay. So if there's a pesticide emergency and people need medical care, your employer should be providing you that transportation to the medical facility. And they should also be providing you with the information of where that medical facility is located. And so when I say that your employer's providing you transportation, that means they're providing transportation for every single person who needs it. So if you've been exposed to pesticides, you really shouldn't be driving, because you're not in a state that's a state of clarity per se. So maybe your employer should be prepared with a big van, because let's say there's like 11 of you and you got all blasted with an airplane flying over that sprayed pesticides on all of you. You are all going to the hospital, and none of you should be driving. So they should pile you in. If it's good enough for Scooby and the gang, I think it's probably good enough for people in a pesticide emergency. And then, like I said previously, if they should be providing you with the name and number of the closest medical facility that you should be going to. And this will be found on the PSIS 8 series. So for if it's an ag situation, it's A8. If it's non-ag, it's N8. But these postings should be anywhere that you are. So if you're out in the field, it should be in the truck, or maybe posted at the entrance to the field, or if it's a mixing and loading site, it's going to be posted at the door, but it needs to be accessible for everyone to see and get that information quickly during an emergency. And I'll take it away to Lisa.
Okay, just a quick snapshot of places where you can report pesticide exposure incidents. So they should be reported to your county ag commissioner, but the Department of Pesticide Regulation has also developed this app called CASPIR. I forget what it stands for, Pesticide Illness Reporting, California, something. I don't know what the S is. It doesn't matter. You can post, you can upload photos to your reporting. It can be anonymous if you need it to, and then it'll get routed to the right place. So we encourage you to use that, and we'll give you a link to that when we send you information after this course. Okay, next slide. So in California, we have mandatory pesticide reporting. So if a physician sees somebody who's been exposed to pesticides, they have to report that. And there's a statewide database called the Pesticide Illness Surveillance Program. And it gives us information on how to prevent emergencies in the future. So that's really good collection of information, but it is mandatory reporting, but it's always good to let people know that so they remember to report. Okay, next slide. Okay. Take-home messages: wear the appropriate PPE when you're handling pesticides. Remember the three C's of controlling pesticide spills: control, contain, and clean. EPA registration number is really important. It's a unique identifier for each pesticide and will help medical professionals give you the most specific care that you need. Never drive yourself to get medical care, like pesticides or not, and pesticide exposure incidents must be reported. Okay, so this is where we'll stick around for questions. We'd love for you to follow up with us in any one of these manners.